Well, today we look at the birth of an earlier political movement known by three short letters. This youth-led movement changed the very language of politics, and its impact is still being felt today. It might sound like a description of Occupy Wall Street, but over two generations ago, growing out of a very similar demand for change, emerged SDS, or the Students for a Democratic Society. This year marks the 50th anniversary of the signing of the 1962 Port Huron Statement, the founding document of SDS. The statement advocated for participatory democracy and helped launch the student movement of the 1960s. Tens of thousands of copies of the 25,000-word document were printed in booklet form.
The statement began with this famous line, quote, "We are people of this generation, bred in at least modest comfort, housed now in universities, looking uncomfortably to the world we inherit." It ended with these words, quote, "If we appear to seek the unattainable, it has been said, then let it be known that we do so to avoid the unimaginable." We're joined by Tom Hayden, one of the founders of SDS, principal author of the Port Huron Statement. Tom Hayden has been deeply involved in social movements for the past half a century. He was a freedom rider in the Deep South, helped create a national poor people's campaign for jobs and empowerment in the early 60s, helped lead the anti-Vietnam War movement, and was indicted with seven others after the 1968 Chicago Democratic Convention. In 1982, he was elected to the California State Assembly. He now runs the Peace and Justice Resource Center, and he's written a cover story for The Nation magazine called Participatory Democracy, From Port Huron to Occupy Wall Street. Tom Hayden, welcome back to Democracy Now!
It's an honor to be here. Good morning.
Well, it was quite something to go down last night, near midnight, to this New York Stock Exchange. And it's interesting, because in the ground it says something like, in 1903, this building, the original stock exchange, occupied this space. And right across the street are scores of people who are, well, doing what they did in Zuccotti Park.
Very good.
You write about the early movement, and you write about today, the significance of the power of these movements. Talk about where you were in 1960, 1961, when you wrote the Port Huron document.
I was the editor of the Michigan Daily in Ann Arbor. I had read Howl by Allen Ginsberg and On the Road by Jack Kerouac, and I was a big fan of James Dean and Rebels Without a Cause and Looking for My Cause. And I met the young black students from the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, and I fell in love with them. And it was because they were the alternative to the life of apathetic absurdity that faced those of us like myself. And they were doing something that they believed in at the risk of their own lives and careers and reputations. And I'd never met people who were willing to make that risk. And that was it. I was gradually converted to becoming an activist. It was not an overnight St. Paul kind of conversion. It was slow. But I came to realize, just as I think Juan did, that you can be a writer, a journalist, an autonomous person, and be deeply engaged and not a propagandist. You begin to see things, see realities by being involved.
So how did Port Huron happen?
I don't know. It was a miracle. It's like, how did Democracy Now! Happen? A few people said it must have been something in the air, something blowing in the wind, and we wanted to write an agenda for our generation. And 50 or 60 people did, and very inspired by SNCC. The first notes toward it were written by myself in an Albany, Georgia jail after a freedom ride. Some of the SNCC people came. They were trying to recruit us, and we wanted to do something about the lack of student power. Students couldn't vote. We could be drafted. There were dorm hours. People would make out with their dates, but there were dorm counselors that made everybody have two couples, three legs on the floor, please. I have to set the timing of this, 1960-62, very special time. So we decided we would write this manifesto, and a professor named Arnold Kaufman suggested we use the term participatory democracy. It also came from Ms. Ella Baker, who was the elder advisor to SNCC, who wanted the students in the South to have an autonomous movement, bottom-up movement, self-determined movement, and not just follow the elder clergy. The components came together, and the statement was somehow produced, and it was called a living document because we thought it should be open to revision. The sentence you read that opened it is not exactly the Communist Manifesto. You know, it's like we're people of this generation, bred in modest comfort, looking uncomfortably. And so we're having a meeting at NYU that everybody's invited to all day today, a reflection. Many of the originals are there. And we're looking uncomfortably on the world we leave behind, perhaps. But yeah. Occupy, it makes us all very happy, very, very pleased. We've seen this come before and go and come again. And it will.
Tom, when you talk about some of the people who participated, talk about some of those early founders of SDS that were with you and that helped develop the original Port Huron statement.
I can't name them all, and I hate to leave anybody out, but right. They're all at NYU. They're not relics. You can go see them. You know some of them. Yeah. Al Haber was the man carrying the idea of a student organization around. He was like the elder of the group. Rob Burledge, who I had dinner with last night, was a editor at the University of Texas newspaper. My first wife, Casey, was a sit-in leader and a kind of existentialist from Austin. There were student body presidents, newspaper editors. SNCC people were there. Charles McDew, who's here in New York, was there. It's an interesting cross section of about 50 people. That's mm-hmm. all.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to go to a clip of you speaking in the early 60s. You're talking about Bob Moses being arrested for registering African American voters. Bob Moses was the field secretary for SNCC, for the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, and director of SNCC's Mississippi Project.
Middle of August, when Bob Moses was arrested on his way back from Liberty, which is the county seat, ironically enough, of Mitt County, he was stopped with several Negroes who had just attempted to register unsuccessfully, and he was arrested by the officer, by the marshal, for disturbing an officer in the process of inquisition or making an arrest, which essentially means resisting arrest. He was booked and he spent a couple of days in jail.
That was Tom Hayden in 1961. I want to go back to the Pacifica Radio Archive. Again, this is Tom Hayden in the early 60s, 1961. Tom, you're helping the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee in Durham, North Carolina. In this clip, you continue to talk about the importance of voter registration.
For a series of reasons, the individuals in the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee have come to see voter registration as the kind of issue and the kind of goal that now is not only possible, but also very desirable in many areas of the South, and the sort of thing that can complement a program of nonviolent direct action.
That's Tom Hayden. Thanks to the Pacifica Radio Archive, we hear you 50 years ago. Voter rights is a key issue even today, even close to 50 years after the signing of the Voting Rights Act, with voter ID laws being passed
exactly.
around the country that are cutting back on people's ability to vote.
Exactly. Well, the movement began with sit-ins, which were occupations of lunch counters. I was a freedom rider. I occupied a train from Atlanta to Albany, Georgia. But very swiftly, the organizers kept hearing from particularly elderly people, black people in the South, I want to vote before I die. I served in Korea. I want just wants to be able to vote. And the principle was to help people accomplish what they already wanted to do. And there was a strategy also because the disenfranchisement of all these people was the power foundation on which the Dixiecrats, the white racist wing of the Democratic Party that dominated all the committees, was based upon. And so it was not an accident that these projects occurred in Macomb, Mississippi, or in Lowndes County, Alabama, or Albany, Georgia. And they weren't, it wasn't an either or of direct action or voter registration, because the vote was a real threat to the status quo. And SNCC people made virtually a blood oath to spend at least 5 years. Nobody knew who would live and who would not, but to attack this problem. And it took great courage, but also strategic intelligence, listening to people who had been waiting for all these years, and it resulted in the Voting Rights Act of 1965, which fortunately had some teeth. That's why the right wing is complaining today, and the Confederate states are complaining, because they're still under a monitoring provision of the 1965 Act. So, in a sense, SNCC accomplished that. I remember I was at a SNCC reunion, 50th last year. Year before, and the Attorney General of the United States, Holder, was there, and he gave a talk, and he said, you know, there's a straight line between those projects in the Deep South and where I sit today at the Department of Justice, and I owe it to SNCC.
But, Tom, there's also another straight line, which is that obviously that Voting Rights Act and then the protests that occurred against the war in Vietnam and led as well to the mass defections from the Democratic Party of so many Southern whites and of course, the Nixon strategy in 68 to basically woo the South, the Republican Party, woo Southern Democrats away. And that really made a major shift in the political alignment in the country for a generation.
I think Juan, that was a failure of the liberal Democrats. The plan was this: risk your neck to do the voter registration, and in doing so, awaken a liberal constituency of clergy, of labor, of like-minded people around the country, and yes, get the white racists out of the Democratic Party base, move them to wherever they want to go, the Klan, the Republican Party, whatever.
Or change them.
I don't remember that being part of the plan. They're entitled to their role. The plan was to replace them with progressive forces and realign the Democratic Party. And the failure, the absolute turning point came where 1964, everything had happened. Kennedy had been assassinated, and SNCC launched the Mississippi Freedom Summer. I went into a long-term community organizing project in Newark with 200 other SDS people. The idea was an interracial or a multiracial movement of the poor to galvanize everybody else. We did not anticipate the war in Vietnam and the draft and the polarization. But the idea was that I think if Johnson had stayed out of the war, you could have accomplished that without the right-wing strategy that followed. It was the right-wing response to the draft resistance, the black uprisings, and all that between 65, 67, that made it possible to have another realignment that favored the rising Republican Party, which is now the Tea Party.
Tom Hayden, we're going to break and back to this discussion. Tom Hayden, longtime activist, former California state senator, one of the founders of Students for a Democratic Society and principal author of the Port Huron Statement written 50 years ago. This is Democracy Now!, back in less than a minute. That's Revolution by Nina Simone, and a shout out to the students from New School University, from the New School for Social Research here in New York, who are watching today's Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. Our guest is longtime activist Tom Hayden on this 50th anniversary of the founding of, well, founding of SDS, but the writing of the Port Huron Statement. Tom Hayden was the principal author of that. We're talking the early 60s. This is the time of John Kennedy. Let's talk about some parallels between organizing in the age of Obama and organizing in the age of John Kennedy. He was not exactly your enemy. How did people organize? And then what happened when he was gone?
It's a good question, and there are parallels. I think, in short, the movement thought that we needed federal protection, and the problem with the federal government was that the Democrats in power had a power base that included liberals, but it also included the Dixiecrat right-wing racist element that prevented anything from happening. And I guess we thought, or gambled, that through direct action and voter registration, we would make them choose. And so we saw Kennedy, I think, evolve a little bit. There's dispute about this, but I think he evolved in 3 years towards more sympathy for the March on Washington, which he initially was worried about because he didn't want to offend the Dixiecrats, march for jobs and justice, not just for voting rights. It was a big deal. It was 1 year after Port Huron. And he also evolved on the question of the nuclear arms race.
Did he evolve? He was pressuring King not to do the 1963 march. It wasn't that he let it happen. It's that King insisted.
Well, the idea was that we had to make them choose. And when a president makes the right choice, you don't claim that you pushed him into it. You say, that's what happened, and so we were successful. Similarly, on the nuclear arms race, the Women's International, what was it? The
League for Peace.
Women's Strike for Peace began the same time around radioactive testing, fallout, mother's milk, contamination. It seemed like very obscure issue, but very real, very human. And we saw Kennedy, especially after the insanity of the Cuban Missile Crisis, which we all lived through 2 months after Port Huron, sign the first nuclear test ban treaty, and then give a speech saying he was critical of the Cold War, that the Cold War with the Soviet Union had to be replaced by a peace race, had to end, and then he was killed. So there was a kind of sense of the possible that we had a hand in creating, but we became might-have-beens. We don't know what might have happened. We were on course. No professor or textbook told us that you should think about assassinations as part of the landscape of history and social change, and they can derail you or distort you in ways you can't even predict.
Well, and the country was on course, maybe domestically, but obviously internationally, it was still involved in expanding the war in Vietnam, the invasion of the Dominican Republic in 65. But I wanted to ask you about the issue of the—you mentioned the occupations, the student occupations that then developed in the late 60s. And I think that's when I first met you in 1968.
I was an occupier with you, I believe.
Yes, at Columbia. And I was just a student, and you were like this already known radical who joined our occupation.
He's a quick learner.
And we actually have a clip of that Columbia strike. And if you could talk not only about that strike, after the clip, but also about the impact of these student occupations in the late 60s on the movement for social change in the country. But let's turn to this brief excerpt from the documentary The Columbia Revolt by Third World Newsreel.
In order to show the solidarity of people with six strike leaders who they tried to suspend, they decided to take Hamilton once again.
Clear it out.
votes, a majority decided to stay.
That was a clip from Third World Newsreel's The Columbia Revolt.
Tom, you recognize faces there.
Quite a few, yes. But Tom, you were in Mathematics Hall, one of the buildings that was occupied along with some of the other groups from the community that joined the struggle then. Talk about not only the Columbia Revolt, but all of the protests, and really the Pentagon protests of 67 against the war that really sort of spurred those movements.
Actually, even before you do that, let's play a clip from that 67 march on Pentagon. This is how it was covered by Universal Newsreel.
You folks are equipped.
Thousands of demonstrators opposed to the Vietnam War assembled in the nation's capital for a mass protest. For the most part orderly, minor scuffles did occur between the demonstrators and hecklers. A three-hour parade takes the demonstrators across the Potomac on their way to the Pentagon. The crowd, estimated at about 50,000 persons, was a loose confederation of some 150 groups and included adults, students, even children. It is at the Pentagon where the first test of strength comes. Military police contain the crowd, but clashes soon break out. Federal marshals arrest several who attempt to break through the protective line. Reinforcing the marshals, a second wave of MPs with fixed bayonets in scabbards move into position.
That was Universal Newsreel covering the 1967 march on the Pentagon. So, Tom Hayden, that march followed by the Columbia and university strikes all over the country.
Well, the headline said that the demonstrators stormed the Pentagon, and the narrator's voice said it was a parade. I leave it to the visual. But I think there's a lot of images of the 60s consist of bedlam, unless you were there. The logic of an occupation, I think, is if you feel voiceless about a burning issue of a great, great importance, and the institutions have failed you, the only way to get leverage for your voice is to occupy their space in order to get their attention. This goes way back. There's occupations of factories in the 30s. You know the history. Occupy Wall Street is only the latest stage, and it's because of the failure of Wall Street, the collapse of the economy, the disappearance of an economic future for this generation of students, and the failure of the political system to deliver reform or jobs. So they occupy. I think at Columbia was expanding its economic interests into Harlem at a time of great racism and exclusion of Puerto Ricans, of blacks, from the university. And they had war contractors that were making money off the war. And students had had enough. And then they tried to kick some students out of school. It's not unlike University of California today or Santa Monica College, where they're pepper spraying kids in response to tuition hikes. And so you occupy. Then, of course, you have to transform. You can't occupy permanently, but it does. It's like the reason for trade unions is to get leverage for working people to advance their wages. An occupation gives the occupiers some leverage to try to get attention to their issues. And if we had leadership in New York State, pardon me, as a foreigner from California, somebody should say, well, we agree with you. We're going to do something about Wall Street now. One, two, three. And maybe the process would move forward. But it seems stuck now, as it was in the early 60s, on the failure of the institutions to do something about a situation that people can't stand.
What about the police response with the occupations around the country, the encampments, the total crackdown, although people are now occupying right across the street from the Stock Exchange and everyday more
you
and
know,
more.
I think from a politician point of view, they can only tolerate so much occupation for their own reasons. But the police should really think about this because they're public employees. There is a conspiracy theory afoot that they coordinated the crackdowns. I don't think we have all the evidence on that. For instance, the sweeping of L.A. was more benign. And it's never benign to have plastic cuffs on you and so on, but it was more benign than New York or Oakland or Chicago. I don't know why, but the police are not the agency to deal with Wall Street. And the use of police only creates further anger, further polarization, as you can see from this morning. It doesn't eliminate the desire to occupy, because that derives not from just trying to stand up to the police. It derives from the fact that you've got, I'll tell you, like at Logan Square, I was interviewing a young man named Bobby, a teaching assistant at Boston College. And I said, why are you here? I'm just interviewing people. And that's my favorite mode. I should be a reporter for your program. He said, where else could I be? There's nothing else to do. And so he was taking his stand in the freezing weather in this tent, because as a college-educated person and a TA, he had no future, and he could find no way to move the institutions to do anything about this obvious fact. That's what they're like.
And your sense of how the Occupy movement not only is a reiteration of past protest movement, but also an advance. What do you think that the Occupy movement has brought different to the movement for social change in America?
I'm a Port Huron expert. It's my little Talmud. I look at it's the Dead Sea Scrolls of the New Left, and I found in it this really stunning reference. It said in the economic section that 1% of Americans own 80% of the corporate stock. And then it went on in the further sentence to say, this despite the fact that the New Deal reforms occurred in the 30s, it's the same 1% since the 1920s when these statistics were measured. So the failure of our generation, if you want to talk in terms of failure or inability, we could diversify, we could democratize, we could pluralize, we could create more space, but the 1% still the 1%. That is the fact. And so if this present movement concentrates on Wall Street, including its various tentacles and impacts, the question is for me, can they take the legacy further and actually do something about the 1%, which has maintained its rule or its influence, not rule, but influence, despite the black presidency, despite the rise of the black caucus, the Latino caucus, the immigrant rights base of the labor movement, the coming and going of the consumer movement, Ralph Nader, all through these years, the women's movement, and there's still all these changes, notwithstanding, there's still the 1%. That's the great opportunity they have to finally get to the business that we failed to finish.
Well, Tom Hayden, I want to thank you very much for being with us. I know you're going over to give a major address at 9:30, which has been switched over to Thompson Street. Is that right?
Don't ask me. It's the center, the NYU Global Center for Spiritual Life.
And there's a conference going on all day at New York University,
exactly,
which people can find
exactly
online.
You can see us. It's come to the zoo of Port Huron, and we welcome everybody. It's a it's a big meeting, big gathering.
Tom Hayden, longtime activist, former California state senator, one of the founders of SDS, Students for a Democratic Society in 62, was the principal author of the Port Huron Statement, the founding statement of SDS. And that does it for this conversation, but you can go online and you can read the transcript and you can get a copy of today's show at democracynow.com.